So we've covered by now the first four chapters of Gilbert Hyatt's classical tradition, which has been the introduction, England in the Dark Ages, France in the Middle Ages, in which we talked about Ovid, and the influence of him fusing with the Provençal troubadours, and the beginning of the French Romance. That's chapter three. And then chapter four was Dante and the inspiration of Virgil, as well as some of the other inspirations, such as Aristotle's Nicomachean Ethics there. Before we get fully into the Renaissance, there is one final chapter that Hyatt goes through, because there's three more key characters who are going to play an important role of gathering some pace in the fluidity of Western literature as it goes towards the Renaissance and away from sort of a medieval mindset. The three characters are Dante's fellow countryman, Petrarch, and Giovanni Boccaccio, and then an Englishman, Geoffrey Chaucer, who will symbolize England's emergence back from its sort of a mini-collapse after Alfred. If you remember, Alfred had brought up the idea of learning and the English language as a literary language to a place of prominence before the later Viking incursions, and then the Norman incursions on top of that set England back from a literary standpoint until we reached Chaucer. So the three key figures are Petrarch, Boccaccio, and Chaucer. We'll start with Petrarch, because Petrarch's life, 1304 to 1347, overlaps Dante the most, and he belongs to the generation after Dante. And in that, he's actually quite striking. He's sort of obsessed with Dante, trying to emulate him, but also obsessed with not trying to emulate him, because he doesn't want to be seen to be a mere copy of him. And he also will look down Dante's nose at Dante, when, for certain things, Dante's choice of the Italian language. Petrarch, far more a pure Latinist. But he highlights the divergence of the culture, this difference between the two, that's occurring in Italy in the 14th century progress. Petrarch, as we said earlier, he doesn't like Dante's use of Italian. It was austere, it was overly austere. And then the friendship between them, or the absence of a friendship between them, really mirrors that of Virgil and Ovid, the relationship between the two. That Virgil was the court poet, and Ovid, of course, is the poet who is thrown out from the court. So Petrarch is younger, as is Ovid, and both saw the greater poets as time has gone on. We can say that Virgil and Dante are the greater poets to Petrarch and Ovid. But Ovid saw Virgil when he was younger, and so did Petrarch see Dante when he was younger, briefly, before attempting to spend their life outdoing their seniors. They both got that glimmer of what sort of being the great court poet was. Now, they were both, this is Ovid and Petrarch, they were both kind of write work which was probably more graceful, but less depth. The themes of what they were going for, the final execution of their works in Ovid and Petrarch, doesn't live up to the scale and scope of what Dante and what Virgil are trying to achieve. Dante's inward looking. He's always looking to go back home to Florence, and he does have this idea of the exile who wants to return home and is very sorrowful for being exiled, whereas Ovid's exile, we don't get any of that in his works. He says, right, well, I'm going to set up a camp here in what's modern-day Constanta, and then almost there's a scorn at those who cast him out, but there's not that longing, and there's less of a regret in Ovid. He got cast out because of the imbecility of others, whereas Dante, there's a much more tragic element of his casting out, his exile. Petrarch, though, was, to just kind of keep this trilogy of exiles going, he was born in exile, is outward looking. He is more a citizen of the world than Dante, and as such he is the wanderer, in the maybe the beginning of that Faustian sense, far more than Dante, because Dante is still in a Middle Age mindset. Petrarch is beginning, we're getting closer to the Renaissance, and so that natural outward looking mode of European thought is coming to the fore. So in addition to that outward looking nature of Petrarch, as opposed to Dante's longing for home, we see that he's actually just a better sourced writer. He's got an extremely well-stocked library, which is that idea of the ideal library for the Renaissance man, is something Petrarch almost is a prototype for. And, you know, we're going to get all the way to Montaigne, and Montaigne is the ideal of the Renaissance man, with the fully furnished, fully accomplished library out in his rural vineyard, where he can forget about the world and head into the library. Petrarch is the pace setter for this. You know, Ronsard, Johnson, Goethe, Voltaire, Milton, Tennyson, all of these follow in that mold of that Petrarch sets up in wanting to have this perfect library, this perfect place of retreat where I can think about the world, think about these grand schemes. Though perhaps because he was in that, he was still an outward-looking man, more so than the later collectivists of that library. He is still searching for manuscripts. He's going to Liège, he's going to Verona, and he's searching for further fragments of Cicero and others such as that. And he, you know, he inspired people such as Carluccio, Salietati, these famous manuscript collectors of the early Renaissance in Italy. And indeed, one of the key classical thinkers to inspire Petrarch is Cicero, whose elements of his Tusculan disputations in Dante's Divine Comedy, but really nothing on the scope of Petrarch's admiration of Cicero. It's far more. He wants that Ciceronian ideal. He wants to be admirable as an artist, stimulating as a thinker, and lovable as a man. So we know he's on this mission to renew the vigor of Greece and Rome and Europe, and it is something that he carries with him for his entire life. That's something we can say of Petrarch, inexhaustible in that endeavor. And he gravitated eventually more towards Plato than Dante's Aristotle in philosophy. It's altogether much less a devout character than Dante, and though he was still a Christian. In which, during that age, you're so much within the sphere of the church still. This is before any Lutheran separatisms. Also, you're Italian, you're closer to Rome geographically, and so you're still occupying that world space, the world space of the Catholic Church. If there's one fault of Petrarch, it's that his works are more imitative. As we see, Dante has Virgil as his guide, going through the Inferno, but the journey Dante, first of all, he brings himself on a journey, whereas Virgil brought Aeneid on a journey. Virgil never really places himself inside a work. And so the voyage of Dante through the Inferno, Purgatorio, and Paradiso is very, very different to the story that Virgil tries to convey. Whereas when Petrarch imitates, it's far much more of a standard copy. He wanted to do a sort of Latin Virgilian style epic on Scipio, and this culminates in his Africa. But it's very much the work of someone imitating the classics rather than a Dante's, which is to be inspired by the classics, but to deliver something far more in tune with his own time and in tune with the worldview of the medieval Middle Age church. We also said that Dante didn't care much for Horace. Petrarch has much more time for Horace. He quotes his odes frequently. And in the Victorian times, Horace was seen as important as Virgil, and Churchill loved learning certain quotes from Horace, and it was well known that his odes and his epistles contained great parts of learning. He was seen on the same pedestal as Virgil. So it's really through Petrarch that we begin to see the placing of Horace on the same level as Virgil. And also, to the far greater extent, Petrarch was interested in reading the tragedies of Seneca, very peripheral to Dante's vision. And he also dabbled in Terence and Plautus, the comedic writers. And despite all this, his attempt to sort of do his own version of the Divine Comedy, which is Petrarch's triumphs, it's far flatter. In the triumph, Petrarch is singular and static, and he's watching this procession of people worthy of veneration go past him. This is the imitative of the Roman triumph coming back successfully from a war. But because he's static, it reflects you reading that as its far drier experience than Dante, who really takes you on a journey. It's notable also that Petrarch never published his Africa, his epic on Scipio, in which he was inspired by Cicero's dream of Scipio. And it's almost as if he reflected that that was a failure and knew it was a failure. So we see similar happening later when Ronsard in the Renaissance tries to complete his French Aeneid, a similar sort of plaster cast attempt to rehash the Aeneid or the Virgilian epic in style and manner. And it's funny that what endures most of Petrarch now, if we think about it, is his imitation of Virgil's eclogues or bucolics, even then which lead him towards his canzoniere or his cantons, his songs of love, which aren't really, they're far from his most classically inspired works, and they're more from the troubadour style, which had been around the courts for centuries, from about 1000 AD. But that's what people think of when they think of Petrarch. And if you're trying to get Petrarch, it's very difficult to get Africa. I don't own a copy of Africa. I have to source it online. And there's not many translations. You can get The Secrets of the Secretum, which is an interesting work. It's in which he divulges his imaginary talkings to Saint Augustine. They talk about characters. It's sort of done in a coffee table format for the time. But also, this wasn't published during his time. But it is, you can obtain that easier than you can obtain Africa. And it's in these secrets actually where we get a lot of understanding about Petrarch's character, his Platonic ideals, his admiration for Cicero, and eventually his underpinning of Boethius's Consolation of Philosophy, which we dealt with already in an earlier part of this series. Lady Philosophy from Boethius is similar to Lady Truth that Petrarch brings in as a characteristic choice, for instance. And his choice of Augustine also shows a medieval tendency, Augustine being a very prominent figure from in the church. And so Petrarch including him with Cicero shows you very much his worldview is still that of the Christian world, not really of a Renaissance man. Renaissance man's interested in Augustine, but I don't think he's putting him on the same pedestal as a Cicero. He's trying to branch out from the Augustinian mold. So we mentioned the canzonieri, which are his songs of love and romantic feelings, largely written for addressing this womanly figure, Laura. It's a sensitivity which feels far more natural when you're reading Petrarch. The Africa is his ambition. It's his want to be of the scale of Virgil. But the canzoniere is far more who he truly is. We have to remember it would eventually inspire the likes of Giacomo Leopardi in his canti, that you can incorporate an Italian tradition of having these cantos. Leopardi is probably succeeding in being a superior character to Petrarch, because in his canto you have both that small loving romantic worldview, and then also he's able to take in the grand themes of ancient Rome in a much more natural way than Petrarch is able to do. So Petrarch really is a sensitive soul and a very good poet. Of course, there's the Petrarch sonnet, which moves up through into England, which eventually through going through Spenserian, you know, Edmund Spenser and Shakespearean mutations, we eventually do come out with Shakespeare's sonnet. But without Petrarch's sonnet, we don't have that. So he is important in that respect, but actually a lot of his works can be seen as a failure. So Petrarch is sensitive when he's bringing in his love for Laura, but he's a bit stale when he's trying a triumphs, or he's trying to imitate Cicero or Virgil. Petrarch is also important in the regard that he was recognized with a laureateship in 1341, only the second to be awarded so since antiquity, and the first to have been conferred in Rome. He really was the reinvigoration of the idea of the poet laureate. So, you know, as a renewal of the Roman ceremony, it was a powerful aesthetic moment that glorified the tradition of Rome, imbued in Europe a belief, a genuine belief, that we can invigorate the classical world in scope and in grandeur. And you have to remember also one of his contemporaries was Colo di Rienzo, or Rienzi, of the Wagnerian opera fame, who was crowned tribune and Augustus some years later and proclaimed a Roman Republic and tried to revive Rome in the 14th century. So the fact that Petrarch is moving in these circles and writing letters to Colo di Rienzi does show that he is genuinely force of nature when it comes to exploring the classical tradition, even if at times his idea of the epic falls somewhat flat.
Thank you.